So let us start with a new topic on electrical machines. And in this lecture, we will discuss on induction motors. First, we will discuss on three-phase induction motors, and then we will move to single-phase induction motor. So here I would start our discussion on AC motors. So previously we have been discussing on DC motors and transformers. Now we have started our discussion with AC motors. So let us see the introduction first. So universal adoption of AC system of distribution of electrical energy for light and power, the field of application of AC motors has widely considered. So earlier, as you know, that DC system was there for the generation as well as transmission of electric power, and then AC system was adopted. So nowadays universal adoption is there for the AC system. Generally, if you see any of the lightning load where, or any of the motor where the power is being consumed, they are consumed in the form of AC. And as such, the AC motors have been widely considered. So that is the reason most of the motors nowadays you will be seeing is AC motors. So as regard to the principle of operation, AC motors can be classified into two categories. So AC motors we will be studying based on the principle of operation. So what is the principle of operation and under which category we are classifying the AC motors? So first motor is the synchronous motors, and second is known as the asynchronous motor or the induction motor. So these are the two classes of AC motors which we are going to cover. And synchronous motor, for the time being, let me make you understand what is the difference between a synchronous motor and asynchronous motor. Synchronous motor is the one where the field and the rotor are rotating at the same speed. That is, the speed of the field and the speed of the rotor is being rotated at the same speed. Whereas in induction motor or asynchronous motor, the field is not rotating at the speed of the rotor. Means both are having different speed. That is the reason it is known as asynchronous motor. And here asynchronous motor can be of various types, where our discussion will be pertaining to the induction motors. Induction motor can be squirrel cage or slip ring. So this is on the basis of the construction of the induction motor. So induction motor we will study into two categories. One is known as squirrel cage induction motor, and another is known as slip ring induction motor. So the difference between the two motor, we will see what is the difference between the construction. For the time being, you just understand that wherever we can add external resistance, wherever we can add, that is known as slip ring induction motor. And in squirrel cage induction motor, we can't add any external resistance. So no resistance can be added to the squirrel cage induction motor. So this is the cutout section of an induction motor. So let us see what are the parts that we have. So generally we have discussed that any motor in our DC machine, we have discussed that any motor will have two parts. One is stator and another is a rotor. And in accordance with Faraday's law, EMF can be generated only when there is a change in the flux. So d phi by dt. So this change in the flux can be possible to produce the EMF is by first changing the conductor, the rotating the conductor, keeping the conductor stationary, rotating the field, or keeping the field constant and rotating the conductor, anything. So here in case of induction motor, our field will be rotating. So understand one thing, the field will be rotating and the conductor will be stationary. So in order to produce the torque or the EMF, what we will do is that we will keep the conductor stationary and the field will be rotating. You know that the one which is rotating is known as the rotor. So here this will form the part of the rotor. So the field or the rotor is the same thing. Here you will be having a rotor. And The stationary one is the stator, so the conductor will be your stator. So wherever the conductor is there, that is known as the stator. So the field is rotating, which will be involving the rotor, and the conductor will be stationary, so it is known as the stator. So this part is the cast iron frame, and here you can see that different slots are there. So there you have the stator coils. So stator coils are there, which are basically the current carrying conductors, and this is your rotor. So this rotor, we have taken an example of a squirrel cage rotor. The rotor can be slip ring rotor also. So this is a rotor which is basically rotating. So this is your shaft. So this is your shaft which is rotating with the help of a ball bearing. And these are basically the outer cover which we have. This is the outer cover which is closing the entire delicate part of the machine. And we have a cooling fan to cool the motors. And the other part we have, which is the wiring box and other things. So main part of the any motor is the stator and the rotor. Stator is the stationary part and rotor is the rotating part. We know that EMF will be established only when there is something relative motion. So in order to produce the relative motion, we keep the conductor stationary. So that forms a stator, and the field will be rotating, so it forms the part of the rotor. And then as such, according to Faraday's law, the EMF will be produced, and hence such the torque will be produced. So this is again, that was the cutout section of the motor, and here you have the rotor. This is your outer frame. These are the conductors that is present, which is known as the stator, and you have the motor shaft which is rotating for the external load. So here the load will be connected. Now let us go with the principle. What is the general principle of the induction motor? So as a general rule, conversion of electric power into mechanical power take place in the rotating part of an electric motor. So you know that there is a power conversion. So when electrical energy is converted to mechanical energy, then it is known as the motoring principle, and here it is taking place in the rotating part of the electric motor. So there is a conversion of electric power into mechanical power for the rotating action. Now in DC motor, now we'll compare the DC motor with the induction motor or the AC motor. In DC motor, the electric power is conducted directly to the armature, that is rotating part, through brushes and the commutator. So if you remember when we were discussing the DC motor, so in DC motor, basically the conductor were rotating and the field was stationary. So field was stationary in case of your DC motor, and the conductor were rotating or moving. Okay, so electric power in DC motor was conducted directly to the armature. So armature is basically the rotating part. So here your rotating part is the conductor. So this is your rotor or the armature. So this is about the DC motor. We are discussing for the DC motors. So in the DC motor, the rotor is the armature where the conductor is rotating, and through brushes and the commutator, our power was transferred, and that is conduction principle. So this is conducted. Hence DC motor are called conduction motor because the power was transmitted conductively. So DC motors are basically known as conduction motors. However, now we will compare with the AC motor. In AC motor, the rotor does not receive electric power by conduction. So if you see, you have a stator and a rotor. So this is your stator and this is your rotor. So rotor is basically rotating, stator is stationary. And between the stator and the rotor, there is an air gap. So you have an air gap between the stator and the rotor. So like in DC motor, where the power was transferred conductively through brushes and commutator, AC motor, rotor does not receive electric power by conduction. So from stator to rotor, the transfer of power, there is no conduction. There is no conduction, but the power will be transferred by induction principle in exactly the same way as a two-winding transformer receives its power from the primary. So if you remember the transformer action, so this is the core of the transformer and this is the primary winding and this is the secondary winding. So whenever we give a supply to the primary winding to take a primary current, and as such the flux is produced here, and this flux links with the secondary coil, and as such the induced EMF is there on the secondary winding. So there is everything induction, there is no conduction because the primary coil and secondary coil are not connected to each other. Similarly, if you consider the stator to be the primary winding of the transformer and rotor to the secondary winding of the transformer, then the supply voltage, whatever we give to the primary winding, we will be giving to the stator, and the transfer of power from the primary winding to the secondary winding through the principle of induction, similar principle will occur here. The power will be transferred from the stator to the rotor crossing the air gap, and the rotor will form the secondary part of the transformer. So here it has to travel an air gap for the transfer of power, whereas in transformer, if you remember, there is a core which is made up of some ferromagnetic material. But in induction motor or any AC motor, not only induction motor, in AC, any AC motor, whether it is a synchronous motor or whether it is an induction motor, there will be an air gap through which the magnetic field has to be established so that power is being transmitted from the stator to the rotor. And hence, as such, the losses will be more. The losses will be more because the power has to establish, or the flux has to establish in the air, and since it is rotating, there will be some friction losses. But in transformer, as flux is established in the core, which your permeability is quite high, so it is very easy to establish the flux in the core as compared to the air, where the permeability is very poor, and hence the losses will be more. So if you compare the efficiency of the transformer with the induction motor, we can say that the transformer will be more efficient as compared to the induction motor. Thus, such motors are known as induction motor. So AC motors work on the principle of induction for the transfer of power from the stator to the rotor, and hence it is known as induction motors. Okay, whereas the DC motors, the power is being transmitted conductively, hence it is known as conduction motors. In fact, an induction motor can be treated as a rotating transformer. Now, this is the analogy between a transformer and an induction motor. Induction motor can be treated as a rotating transformer. Transformer is a static piece of apparatus, whereas an induction motor, the primary winding is stationary. So primary winding is stationary, so this forms the stator, and the secondary winding is free to rotate, which is basically the rotor. So induction motor analogy with the transformer is basically, it can be said to be a rotating transformer, where the primary winding is stationary, forms a stator, and the secondary winding is free to rotate, which forms the rotor. Now, of all the AC motor, the polyphase induction motor is the one which is extensively used for various kind of industrial drives. So polyphase induction motor, polyphase means, so here in induction motor, we are describing three-phase induction motor, three-phase induction motor. Whereas polyphase induction motors, we can have more number of phases compared to three. So here three-phase induction motor is there. There can be some application where more number of phases are involved. So generally three-phase induction motors are the one. So in AC motors, of all the AC motor, whether it is a synchronous motor, single-phase induction motor or anything, three-phase induction motor was the one which is extensively used in industrial drives. So we will discuss some of the advantages and the disadvantages of the induction motors. So first, let us take the advantage. So first advantage is simple and extremely rugged. almost unbreakable construction, especially squirrel cage type. So if you see the induction motor, it is construction is very simple, okay, and the construction is very rugged, and as such it can be used in any type of environment, like in explosive areas. So in explosive areas or in cement industries where a lot of dust are there and there is a heavy chance of explosion and other things, we will be using the induction motor and especially the squirrel cage type. So you remember that two type of induction motor we have discussed. One is squirrel cage and another is slip ring induction motor. So especially squirrel cage induction motor is the one which is simple and extremely rugged. Its cost is low and reliable. So if you compare the cost of the induction motor as compared to the DC motor, the cost will be low because there will not be any commutator. So due to the not presence of the commutator, the cost become low, reliable, and it is simple in construction. So sufficiently high efficiency. So its efficiency is quite good. In normal running condition, no brushes are needed. So you do not require any brushes, which was required in case of the DC machine. So no brushes are needed, hence friction losses are reduced. It has reasonably a good power factor. So in induction motor, your efficiency is quite good or high, you can say, and power factor is also quite good, and there is no brushes needed in induction motor, and as such the friction losses will be reduced. It requires minimum maintenance. So as it is extremely rugged in construction, it requires minimum maintenance. So maintenance cost is low. It starts from rest and need no extra starting motor and has not to be synchronized. So whenever we are discussing the induction motor, it will be starting from the rest position. So the motor is standstill and it is not needing any extra motor to start. So we will discuss that three phase induction motor are self starting motors. So we are discussing the self starting motors. So three phase induction motors are self starting motors. It do not require any extra starting motor and has not to be synchronized. So whenever we will discuss the synchronous motor, you will see that an extra motor is required to for the principle of synchronization, so that the synchronous motor becomes synchronized of NS is equal to NR, which is not required in case of our induction motor, and as such no extra starting motor is required. Starting arrangement is simple, especially for the squirrel cage type. So squirrel cage type, you know, there is no external resistance, and the starting arrangement, so we will see how the starting arrangement varies of the squirrel cage with slip ring induction motor. So starting arrangement is simple and has, so these are the basic advantages of the induction motor, which makes it to be very much useful in case of the industrial drives. So simple, rugged in construction, low cost, reliable, sufficiently high efficiency, no brushes, good power factor, friction losses are reduced, minimum maintenance, it do not require any extra starting motor to be synchronized, arrangement is simple, and no starting arrangement is required. Now we will cover the disadvantage. There are some limitations of the induction motor. Let us see that. Its speed cannot be varied without sacrificing some of its efficiency. So speed regulation, so this speed changing from the no load to the full load cannot be varied without sacrificing some of its efficiency, which is a major limitation of the induction motor. You can't vary the speed so much. Just like a DC shunt motor, its speed decreases with the increase in the load. So if you remember, in a DC shunt motor, your speed was decreasing with the increase in the load. So its induction motor behaves similarly at DC shunt motor. And in shunt motor also, if you remember, that you can't vary the speed so much. Speed is mostly constant. So here also speed is mostly constant. its starting torque is somewhat inferior than that of the DC shunt motor. So if you compare the starting torque of with respect to the DC shunt motor, it is not quite good as compared to DC shunt motor. So starting torque is somewhat inferior. So these are the limitations. So speed cannot be varied, and its speed decreases with the increase in the load. So whenever you put more load on the induction motor, its speed will decrease, the rotor will rotate at the low speed, and starting torque is inferior compared to DC shunt motor. Now we will cover the applications. So let us see the applications of the induction motors. So we'll classify the induction motor into single phase induction motors and three phase induction motor. Three phase induction motors are mostly used in industrial and commercial applications, whereas single phase induction motors are used in low power and domestic applications. So wherever you have domestic applications or low power requirement, we'll go for single phase induction motors, and wherever the power requirement is quite high, we'll go for the industrial or commercial application, we'll go for three phase induction motors. So first, because 98% of the motors that we use in industries are basically the three phase induction motors. So it can be used in lift, cranes, hoist pump, large capacity exhaust fans, driving lathe machines, crushers, oil extracting mills. These are some of the industrial applications. If you use in the domestic applications like pumps, compressors, small fans, mixers, toys, high speed vacuum cleaner, electric saver or drilling machines, there you will go for single phase induction motors, which are of low power applications. Now let us discuss the construction of the induction motor. So induction motor generally consists of two main parts. So we have discussed that induction motor will have two main parts. One is known as the stator, another is known as the rotor. So rotor is rotating and stator is stationary. So this is the basic requirement for any motor. So it will have two main parts. Now let us cover the stator first. So stator is basically the stationary one. So stator is made up of number of stampings which are slotted to receive the winding. So if you see the stator, it will be in the form of circle, and there will be lot of stampings where the winding will be there. So it will be made up of number of stampings slotted to receive the winding. It carries a three phase winding and is fed from a three phase supply. So in motoring application, you know that electrical energy will be converted to the mechanical energy. So the three phase winding which is present in the stator stamping is receiving power from a three phase supply. So there will be three phase supply R, Y and B, which will be transferring power to the stator, and it will carry a three phase winding. So it will be wound for a definite number of poles. Now these poles will play a very important role to determine the speed of the machine. So we will see how it. So it is wound for a definite number of poles, the exact number of poles being determined by the requirement of the speed. So speed determine how many number of poles you require. Okay, so there is a direct relationship between the speed and the number of poles. Greater the number of poles, lesser the speed, and vice versa. So if you increase the number of the poles, obviously the speed will be lesser. So speed will be decreasing. So if you increase the number of poles, then the speed will fall. And speed, poles and speed are related to each other. So stator winding, when supplied with a three phase current, so let us understand with a diagram. So this is your stator which is carrying the stamping, and this is your rotor. So stator is being supplied with a three phase supply. So you will be having a three phase supply in the stator. So you have R, Y and B. This is the three phase supply. So stator winding will carry the three phase current. So there in the stator you have the stamping which is carrying the three phase current, and it is producing a magnetic flux. So you know that a current carrying conductor will produce a flux. So here the three phase current carrying conductor will produce a magnetic flux, which is of constant magnitude. So magnitude will be constant of the flux, but which revolve at a synchronous speed given by NS is equal to 120 F by P. Now this is the most fundamental equation which we are going to use in AC machine. So synchronous speed is 120 F by P, where F is the frequency of the supply. So F is the frequency of supply and P is the number of poles. So P is the number of poles. Now you understand that the poles and speed are basically related to each other. So greater the number of poles, lower the speed. Now in stator, which is carrying the stamping, you are giving the three phase supply. So these three phase supply, due to the three phase current, magnetic flux is produced whose magnitude is constant, but it is revolving at a speed which is the synchronous speed given by 120 F by P. This revolving magnetic flux induces an EMF in the rotor by the principle of mutual induction. So there will be an EMF in the rotor. So this rotor is basically behaves as the secondary of the transformer. So the secondary winding of the transformer behave the same way as the rotor of the induction motor. So how the principle is? So you have a three phase supply. This three phase supply is going to the three phase conductor stampings of the stator. So there is a flux produced in the air gap. So there is a flux produced in the air gap whose magnitude is constant, but which is revolving in this air gap. So it is revolving in the air gap with a speed which is a synchronous speed given by 120 F by P, F being the frequency of the supply and P being the number of poles. Now the revolving magnetic flux in the air produce an EMF in the rotor conductor. So rotor will have some conductor. So this is the similar way to the secondary of the transformer. This is the primary of the transformer. So this links with the conductor present in the rotor, and due to the principle of mutual induction, there will be an EMF produced in the rotor. So this principle is similarly to a two-winding transformer. So if you have understand a two-winding transformer, you can easily understand the rotor, the induction motor principle. Only difference is that it will be having an air gap instead of the core. So the core is basically the air and the field is revolving. That is the difference. The field is revolving in the air gap, whereas in transformer, the field is in a sinusoidal. This is what discussion about the stator. Now we'll cover the rotor. So rotor is basically of two types. So first type is basically the squirrel cage rotor, and second one is basically the phase wound or wound rotor, or the other name is slip ring. So other name is slip ring induction motor. So there are two type of rotors in induction motor. The first rotor is known as the squirrel cage rotor, and the second one is the phase wound or wound rotor or slip ring induction motor. So any name you can give it. So let us first see the squirrel cage rotor. So we have discussed in the first introduction part that squirrel cage rotor, you will be not able to connect an external resistance, whereas slip ring induction motor, you can connect the external resistance. So squirrel cage rotor, 90% of the induction motors are basically squirrel cage type. So if you see the type of the rotor, and the most number of rotors are basically squirrel cage type, about 90% of the induction motor. What is the reason? The reason is it is simple in construction, it is rugged and almost indestructible. So that is the reason 90% of the induction motors are basically squirrel cage type. Now, what is the rotor made up of? The rotor consists of cylindrical laminated core with parallel slots for carrying the rotor conductors, which is the heavy bars of copper, aluminium, or any alloys. So if you see, observe carefully, these are the bars that are present in the rotor. So these are the bars that are present in the rotor, which is made up of either copper, aluminium, or any type of alloys. And they are heavy bars. So they are heavy bars which form the rotor conductor. So these heavy bars of copper, aluminium, or alloys are connected to the slots. So if you can see here, these are the slots. So these slots, and this side also slots will be there. So they are fixed to the slots of the rotor. So this is your squirrel cage rotor, which is very rough and almost indestructible. So there will be some slots and the bars, which are very heavy in the form of copper, aluminium, or alloys, are present, and the end rings are sorted. So here, after connecting it, the end rings are sorted. So these are the squirrel cage construction. So one bar is placed in each slot. So one slot will have one bar. These are very heavy bars. The rotor bars are electrically welded to two heavy and stout short circuit end rings. So if the bars which are present in the slot are electrically welded, and they are short circuited with the help of end rings. Since rotor bars are permanently short circuited, now this is not temporary, this is permanent short circuit is there on themselves, hence it is not possible to add any external resistance in series with the rotor circuit for starting purpose. Now we will see that why we want a resistance to be added to the rotor circuit. So the rotor circuit requires an external resistance to be added, which will help the starting torque. So this will help the starting torque. But in squirrel cage induction motor, since the rotor bars are permanently short circuited, there is no provision of adding an external resistance. Hence, the starting torque of the squirrel cage rotor will not be varied, which is a limitation of the squirrel cage induction motor. The rotor slots are usually not quite parallel to the shaft, but are purposely given slight skew. Now, if you see that these rotor bars are not straight, these are not straight, rather than these are little bit tilted or skewed. Okay, so the rotor bars are not straight, these are little bit skew type. So what is the reason? So what is the reason that we have not kept it straight? It helps to make the motor run quietly by reducing the humming, magnetic noise that is known as the hum. So there is a magnetic noise, hissing noise, which is known as the hum. So it will reduce that noise and the motor will run quietly. Second, it helps in reducing the locking tendency of the rotor. So locking tendency of the rotor, that I told that if synchronous speed is equal to rotor speed, then this is known as the synchronous motor. Now, NS should not be equal to NR in case of induction motor. So the locking tendency of the rotor means the rotor and stator teeth will lock each other in case of the synchronous motor, which will not lock in induction motor. So it will reduce that locking tendency if the rotor bars are little bit skewed. The tendency of the rotor teeth to remain under the stator teeth due to direct magnetic attraction between the two is known as the locking tendency of the rotor. So in case of the synchronous motor, when we will discuss, you will see that the rotor teeth and the stator teeth locked each other, and as such the synchronous speed become equal to rotor speed, and that is the reason it is known as the synchronous motor. However, due to the skewing of the rotor, there is reducing the locking tendency of the rotor. So first we have discussed the squirrel cage induction motor. Now we will go for wound rotor phase wound or slip ring induction motor construction. So only one point of discussion here is that we will connect an external resistance to the circuit. So this slip ring induction motor will provide a provision to connect the external resistance. So rotor coils are three phase double layer distributed winding. It is not the bars. So if you remember in squirrel cage induction motor, we have talked about the heavy bars of copper aluminium. So here you will be having coils. So instead of bars, you will be having coils, which are three phase double layer distributed winding. Rotor has many poles as the number of stator poles and is always wound three phase even when the stator is wound for two phase. So there will be stator and there will be rotor. So this is your stator, this is your rotor. So here the rotor will have some number of poles which is there due to the product, this flux which is produced, which is rotating, it has to locked with the coils which is there in the rotor. So in slip ring induction motor, this is in the form of a coils which are three phase double layer distributed winding, and the rotor will have many poles and as the number of stator poles. So stator will have some poles, so rotor will have some poles, and is always wound three phase even when the stator can wound for two phase. So stator supply can be three phase or two phase. So you can give three phase supply to the stator or two phase supply to the stator, but the rotor poles will always be three phase. So rotor can't have two phase, rotor will always be three phase. So now we will see like why we can give three phase supply or why we can give two phase supply. Because the major reason why we are giving this supply is to produce the flux in the air gap, which is of constant magnitude and revolving at the synchronous speed. So this is the squirrel cage rotor and this is the wound rotor. There is a difference between these two. So these are the bars. So these are, you are seeing the laminated cores, which are the bars, which is present here. And you have the coils, which is present in the rotor. So instead of bars, you will be having the coils, which is present. And due to the presence of the coils, you can add external resistance to the rotor. But squirrel cage rotor, you can't add the resistance because the rotor bars are short circuited. So these are short circuited permanently. There is no provision of adding any external resistance. There is provision of adding an external resistance to the wound rotor. So let us describe a little bit the construction. The three phase are stored internally. So the three phase that is present in the rotor are starred. Starred means you have a star supply. So this is your star supply with the neutral grounded. So three phase which is present in the rotor are starred internally, and other three terminals are brought out and connected to the three insulated slip ring mounted on the shaft with brushes resting on them. So the three connection are grounded and starred, and other three terminals, these two three terminals are brought out, which are insulated with the help of a slip ring, and they are mounted on the shaft. To say it will be having a shaft which will rotate the load. So this will be connected to the three windings. So here one winding, second winding and third winding. These three brushes are further externally connected to a three phase star connected rheostat. So you have a three phase star connection of the rotor, where internally it is connected. So this is your internal connection and this is the external connection. Externally it is connected to the shaft and there will be three brushes. Okay, this makes possible that introduction of additional resistance. So additional resistance will be coming because these are not short circuited and they are connected with the brushes, which are further connected with the rheostat at the external. So additional resistance you can connect in the rotor circuit during the starting period. So this is only at the starting period. When the rotor is rotating, your resistance will be cut out. So this resistance, whatever we are connecting in the rotor circuit, it is only during the starting period. So for increasing the starting torque, so why we are adding the resistance? We want the starting torque to be high. So if starting torque to be high, we have to connect an external resistance in the rotor circuit, which is not possible in squirrel cage rotor because the rotor bars are completely permanently short circuited. So here, since the rotor bars, rotor coils are start connection with external supply given with the help of brushes, so we can connect an external resistance which will form a rheostat connection externally, and due to the connection of this resistance, we can vary the torque, starting torque, and the speed torque current characteristic will change. So we can modify the speed torque current characteristic. So under normal running condition, so when this is about the starting condition, what happened in the normal running condition? Under the normal running condition, the slip rings are automatically short circuited like the squirrel cage induction motor. So slip rings will be again short circuited under the normal running condition by means of a metal collar which is pushed along the shaft and connected all the rings together. So this is the under the running condition, and this is under the starting condition. So this is, you have the starting condition and here you have the running condition. So starting condition, you will connect an external resistance to the rotor circuit which will vary the starting torque, and as such the speed torque characteristic will change. However, in the running condition, the slip ring will be automatically short circuited and it will behave similarly to squirrel cage rotor, and it will be with the help of a metal collar that is pushed along the shaft and connected all the rings together to form the short circuit. So this is the circuit which we are talking about regarding the star connected rotor winding of the wound rotor or the slip ring induction motor. So you have a three phase R, Y and B. So R, Y and B are internally connected. So the brushes are automatically lifted from the slip ring to reduce the friction losses and wear and tear. So let us see. So you have this external connection coming from R, external connection coming from Y, and external connection coming from B. So these connections will go to the R, Y and B of the slip rings. So it will be connected with the slip ring and there will be three brushes. So you can see this black color, these are basically the brushes, and the central point, this one is basically the shaft which is locking the rotor with the external circuit. Now there will be a rheostat which will be taken from the RYB connection. So this is which is forming an external star connection. So under the starting condition, you can vary the resistance. You can vary the resistance with the help of this rheostat. So vary the resistance with the help of this rheostat in the starting condition. However, in the running condition, this slip ring, these three slip rings will be automatically short circuited and it will behave as the squirrel cage induction motor. In the normal running condition, the wound rotor is short circuited on itself just like the squirrel cage rotor. So the difference between the wound rotor or slip ring induction motor and squirrel cage rotor is only during the starting period. In the running condition, you will be having no difference between the slip ring or the squirrel cage rotor. So we have completed the discussion on the introduction of the three-phase induction motor. We have discussed the advantage, limitations, applications, and the construction of the rotor and the stator circuit.